So the closer of Habitat, rocking my homemade tie-dye shirt, and this has been a live staple with you guys for years now. So when did like how did this song start? Like, what's the origin of this other fossil?
Yeah, man. That's the other, yeah. That's one of the other old ones on it. 2008, when I started the band, the Red Lights, with my cousin David, and my brother Thomas joined like 2 weeks, 2.5 weeks in. But the first day, like, it was just me and David and my friend Robbie, which you know, Robbie C.
Oh, man.
We went to the studio, the rehearsal studio that me and Robbie rented at the time. I had a dream that David and I were in a band called the Red Lights, and I was having a hard time in the band I was in, so I wanted to like write all these stripped down songs, and I just wanted to like not worry about needing people like bandmates because people were bailing all the time and not making it. I was like, screw it, I'll just play. Me and David's always hanging out, so David will play drums, I'll play and sing, and we won't even need a bass player if Thomas doesn't want to do it. Thomas, my brother, and who just called me right now as we're talking. I put up pictures of us. He doesn't like when I put pictures of him online. I hope he's not yelling at me to take them off because they were really nice pictures,
Your brother's not on social media?
No, he's not, and he's really hung up. He's a teacher, and he's like, one time I put up a picture of us, and he's like, take it down. He called me like immediately. His wife saw it online, and he's like, take it down. I'm not supposed to be on the internet, but I'm like, dude. Like every one of my friends is a teacher. They just like don't put your full name. That's like basically what the rule is. No, take it down, take it down. And he got like pissy about it. So, but man, it's a part of our own personal
I
music
got friends who are
history.
teachers, and they're all up on social
Yeah,
media.
yeah.
So,
I feel kind of bad. I blocked his wife. Not blocked his wife. I mean, like I made it so all your friends except for his wife could see it online. So, I hope he doesn't find out. Never forget what we were talking about. Oh yeah, homemade tie-dye shirt. Yeah, man. So anyway, the Red Lights started and we wrote all these songs. Like I woke up and I wrote like three or four songs and a lot of songs that we still play today. It Just Stopped Raining, The Base of Everything, homemade tie-dye shirt, a bunch of others that I can't remember right now. But what was I gonna say? So David and I, we were having these sessions like the next few days. We just got together. We were really excited about the idea, and we would get together, me, David, and Robbie, and write these songs and record them. And we showed up the one day. My car was in the shop, and my mom dropped me off. And for some reason, I don't remember what happened, but she dropped me off. I told her I wasn't worried about getting home, that my friends would be there. And I just sat there like writing songs for a few hours. Then David came once he was like done with school or whatever, and we both had homemade tie-dye shirts on. So we had like this song that we wanted to be just like straightforward jamming, open-ended, so we could like jam, but as a two-piece or three-piece, you listen to the lyrics, they're like half just, weird conceptual poetry, no exact story, just scenes from hanging out and things that happened at the time and funny things I was saying at the time and shit, So, yeah, we both just showed up wearing homemade tie-dye shirts, so that's how that became the first line and the name of the song, and then the rest of it was just kind of rhyming and and then we were talking about the movie Powder. Robbie brought up the movie Powder, so that line, I feel like powder and I'm
great
ready to
movie.
blow. Yeah, I never actually saw it, but the line is like because Robbie was talking about the movie, and yeah, we were just kind of messing around, and through the years, it's kind of evolved into like it's got like this intricate middle part that we like go batshit crazy on now, and we kind of like, it's just been like a lot of those songs. The reason why we have a lot of those old songs that end up on newer records, they're like half new songs, half old songs, is because like David and Jimmy were like fans of like the Red Lights and the bands I had beforehand, and a lot of those songs didn't really get played too much because like I wrote them and then the band would flake out and we wouldn't be able to gig that much. And then we broke up for a long time and I didn't want to hear those songs and it upset me. And also, like every artist, I felt like what I was doing at the time was better than what I did. So I wasn't interested in going back and playing the old songs. And then through the years, I've started to feel nostalgic about them. And a lot of times Jimmy and Julian will like bring it up. And I'll like play it and then play a part of it. And they'll like have already learned. Like, I've never taught them any of the old songs. We really play them because Julian and Jimmy want to play them. And then I don't want to be a pain in the ass to Ryan to show him how they go. So Ryan just plays them and he asks them, and if there's something specific, we show him. But, you know, I let them like arrange their own parts and everything. And they kind of evolve and became Medicine Fish songs. And I forget how old they are because a lot of them disappeared for like 5 or 6 years or 10 years. And then have been coming back in the last couple of years. So, it's like, it feels like that. I don't feel like I wrote them a lot of the time. It almost feels like they're a cover song, but it more just feels like it's part of our DNA, you know? And it is just so crazy that I've known people for that long that like know these songs and stuff. So yeah, as much as like I wrote them, they are the ones who like preserved them. And I probably would have forgotten about them if they didn't bring them up half the time. So and then we mix them in Medicine Fish. We like to play those songs. So once in a while, we'll put them into the new records, you know, because they've changed so much and they're not on anything officially released at this point anymore. So they feel like new songs and they, you know, they don't feel like dated or anything. So we like to mix it up.
Do you think it's risky to put, you know, a 15-minute excursion of Rockin' My Homemade Tie-Dye Shirt on an album? Because I know on like your live archives, there are, you know, 12, 13 minute versions of Rockin' My Homemade Tie-Dye Shirt. I think it makes sense for, you know, when you're playing live in a live setting. But do you think that works for like an album to just throw in like a 15, 16 minute song there? Do you think people would, do you think like they would be able to retain that?
Well, it's risky if you have something to lose, you know, which we don't. If I was trying to like appeal to a record company, it would be 3.5 minutes and it would go right into the middle part, you know, the riff.